from the high desert of Southern California and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero.
Alleluia, 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 Yahuwah. Blessings to you, Boker 2. Thank you for being here with us this morning, today. Wow, already approaching the end of this sixth month of the year, 2019. It goes by so fast. Praise Yahuwah. Oh, what a blessed week we've had. I hope your week was just as blessed by Yahuwah with His Word and His truths. I hope that He has given you His peace and His shalom. I hope that in your study of His Word that He has provided a morsel, a nugget of information. Doesn't it just inspire you when you read His Word? Doesn't it just bring you to heights that this world cannot bring you to see something behind that veil that He provides you by His loving Ruach, the Helper? We pray to Yahuwah and we ask Him for that help. Specifically, we do. There's a couple things that I wanted to just remind you about, and you probably already know, but when you do pray for Him, do make sure that you do pray that His name be known, His true name be known, and make sure that you pray that His kingdom and the understanding of that good news, the good news for the people, the hope, the people of this world need hope. And that is what we are at Praise Yahuwah. We are trying to declare the hope of His Word. And that is exactly why you're here, because it resonates with you. So declare that hope to others. And then also too, when you pray, know that there are two who give intercession for you. And most of have come to understand that our Master gives us intercession to Yahuwah, that He provides the proper translation of your heart. And yet there is another according to Scripture. Scripture specifically says that the Ruach of Yahuwah Ruach, provides intercession for you. And so there's a scripture for that. Seek that out in the New Testament. If you haven't found that already, I'm sure you have. But isn't it wonderful to know that you have two of Yahuwah who are providing that intercession? Where our words fail, and oftentimes they do, where our hearts cannot always be known by us, know that our Master and our loving Ruach, Yahuwah's, that they provide this translation to Father of things both thought and said, but things unthought and unsaid of your heart that you have not even put into words. You know, He says that He knows what you need. When you pray to Him, He already knows. And the reason why He knows is because of that intercession that is made of your heart. So an intercession of the heart. Isn't that beautiful? You could almost put that in a greeting card. You know, if you could send a greeting card, that would be a wonderful one, wouldn't it? To lift someone up and to help them to be just brought to that level of hope and faith and belief that you have, that expectation. Well, certainly everything that we have is based on a foundation. And that foundation is our Master. And our Master is the loving representation of an eternal covenant. And so let's fittingly start out this morning, dear brothers and sisters, with a statement of His covenant representation. First of all, He says, "You shall love Yahuwah, your almighty loving Yah of all creation, with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your very being, and you're to love your near one as yourself. And a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just like I have loved you. You also must show love for one another. By this will others know that you are my true disciples, by the way that you all hold love for one another." Well, Dia and I love you, and we love you very much, and we are so entirely grateful that in this vast stretch of the four corners of the world that you're with us here this morning, or that you're listening later on a rebroadcast, and your Ruach is with us. We love you so much. Further, Almighty, Eternal, Loving Yahuwah spoke these 10 covenant words saying, "I am Yahuwah, the Almighty, Eternal, Loving Yah creating His people who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim, out of the house of bondage. Well, we talked about that last week, didn't we? About those in bondage in Egypt. And we're going to speak some more on that today. But the foundation further says, and this is the first covenant word, you shall have no foreign Elohim before your face. The second word here is, you shall not manufacture or consume for yourselves any contaminations, nor any image to worship, not of anything that is in the heavens above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow yourself down to it, nor serve them. For I, Yahuwah, your Almighty, Loving Yah of all creation, I am the only Almighty, Eternal, Loving One. The sins of the fathers are passed on to their children, even to the third and fourth generation of those who ignore me. Yet I send loving invitations 1,000 times to every generation of those who seek to love me and keep my words. Well, we do love our Father, do we not? And we do seek to constantly remove the contaminations of this world. Whatever Yahuwah Ruach is lovingly putting upon our hearts, by way of especially study of His Word, we then put into action the statement, the correction that is caused by that statement, and the walk that is the action of walking in the way of Yahuwah, removing that contamination. Now, contaminations are something that Scripture points out in various places, and it's for you to study. It's for you to decide, what is this contamination? Yahuwah will reveal to you the contaminations of this world for you to slowly remove everything. Some things we remove quickly. Other things we realize over time. Oh yeah, I was doing this or that and I shouldn't probably do that. Because you're purifying yourself. You're washing. When you wash your robe or you wash a shirt or you wash anything of your clothing, it doesn't immediately come clean. Nope. We have to put some oxy wash on it or whatever it is we use, and we have to scrub it. Sometimes we have to soak it and really, really work it to get those stains out. Well, that's what you're trying to do, and that's what we'll continue to do until the day that Yahuwah comes for us. Now, do not treat my name, Yahuwah, as unimportant, for it is the first gate of salvation. Brothers and sisters, the first gate of salvation is the great and important name of our Almighty, Loving Yahuwah. And so the doorway is Yahuwah. Yehuda being the tribe that declared that statement by way of their name. And so we will also do the same in our walk. Very important. And make no excuses for any other name or names. Remember the Shabbat day to keep it set apart, the fourth commandment. Labor 6 days, do all your work. Seventh day is set apart to Yahuwah. You shall labor 6 days, do all your work, but the seventh day is the pledge day to Yahuwah, the Almighty, Loving Yah, who is creating His nation. Now you shall not do any work in it, you nor your son, nor your daughter, your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your livestock, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days Yahuwah made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but He rested the seventh day. Therefore Yahuwah blessed the Shabbat day, made it set apart. Number 5, honor your father and your mother in your walk in Yahuwah, that your days may be long in the land which Yahuwah, Almighty, Loving Yah of all creation gives to you. Number 6, you shall not murder. 7, shall not commit adultery. 8, shall not steal. 9, shall not give a false testimony to a near one. 10, you shall not lust after anything about your near one's house. You shall not seek after your near one's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your near ones. Yes, brothers and sisters, all these done in the loving way of Master. So every time we do something in our walk, whatever it is we do, whatever it is we say, let us do this, let us say this in a way that is loving. And certainly, Dee and I love you so much, and we're so grateful for all of you being here. Thank you, dear sisters, for being in chat. We love you so much for that because you are so supportive. You are here with us always, it seems, and we are grateful for you. because your heart and everything you do, I notice, especially those of you that haven't been in our chat room, everything that our sisters say and do is very much in the loving way of our Father and Master. You'll notice a difference in people, in their walk, where they are spiritually, by what they say and the way they say things, and even what they don't say. And so I've learned over many years that you can really tell a lot, especially about our sisters, by their hearts showing how they are and who they are in what they say and what they do in their loving ways. And it's a wonderful thing. I tell you, in my life, and even when I first came to know Yahuwah, I did not know people who were as loving as those of you who email us as well. Those of you in chat, but those of you who email us and give us your love from all over the world, and who, by your words, really show that you are one of Yahuwah's people. There's an ingredient in you that is so different from everybody else. And I'm grateful for you, because all these other religions and groups and gatherings that we've ever been with, we've never known anyone so beautiful and so loving. So thank you for being here. And we hope that you feel the same way about us. And I know that as a tight family, that we are rooting for one another by way of our prayers, by way of our thoughts, our conversations constantly with Yahuwah. See, He knows all about you, dear brothers, and especially you too, dear sisters, because we pray for you and we talk to Yahuwah all the time about you. And we thank Him for you and we pray His blessings and His protection for you. Well, He already knows these things, doesn't it? Because He knows our hearts. And so, brothers and sisters, we learned this week some incredible things by way of the Jonah Code. Well, I hope you don't get tired of the Jonah Code, because let me tell you, we have over 57 pages of words that Yahuwah has provided. Not that He's told us, whispered to us or talked to us. No. What Yahuwah does is in our studies. He moves us, and we are given thoughts that are triggered by way of His word. When we study, that studying is very important. It opens a veil. It opens a channel, a doorway of truth to your mind that's already there. See, we're not special. Nobody's special to receive anything. It's just that when you're studying His word and seeking in it, He allows you to see what that word already has in it. He's already had prophets all through the ages that have done their work and have written it down, and it has been translated. And now it's the loving Ruach who allows you to see what is already there, which is why we don't consider ourselves prophets or something special. We're just people of Yahuwah, who He gives these abilities to see what we have not been able to see before and what the world simply cannot see. Well, what Yahuwah did is He allowed us to see something very important this week, and it's by way of the Jonah Code. But also, it is not the Jonah Code, so we feel comfortable in sharing it. But certainly, if you calculate, and this is just a little bit of, I'm going to try to give you guys a little bit of something every week by way of understanding of the significance of the complexity of the design of the word, and then also a chapter or two of the actual chapters that we believe is leading us to by way of understanding, by way of that veil being removed. Now, if you, first of all, I want to say this. Did you know that there was another Mark of the Taw in the last 100 years? Yes, there was. There was a crossing eclipse. And this happened in the late 20s to 1930, the last 7 years of that. So that would have been 1923 to 1930. And this Mark of the Taw actually occurred right over New York, with the apex of that Taw X occurring just off the coast of New York, but with that line going through and slashing right over the financial sector of New York. Did you know in the midst of that ta, this would have been around, let's say 1925? Can't remember exactly what year it was, but it was 5 years before the final crossing of that next mark of the ta that made the fullness of that 7 years. That about 5 years before the end of that, that is when the crash occurred, when it first happened in New York. The financial markets destroyed. And this created the Great Depression. And this Great Depression, like nothing in modern ages anyway, the world has ever seen. And so it affected the entire globe, didn't it? I shouldn't say globe, but face of the earth. There's that earth indoctrination sneaking in. But the entire face of the earth, that it affected everyone. And isn't it interesting? This occurred about 5 years before that final crossing, or 2 years after the beginning of the crossing. That whole 7 years was actually 7 years and a few months. And the entire time of it was 7 years, 7 months, and 7 days. Isn't that amazing? That's how long that entire X was at that time. And so about 5 years before the actual ending of that is when that took place, that great crash. And so, brothers and sisters, I wanted to share that with you because you see, all these signs have meaning. There's reasons for them, and there's understanding behind them. And so the great crossing that we're in the midst of right now, and 5 years before the very last ending of it right now, it's certainly a time for us to wake up, be aware, and be looking for the things that are going to occur. Nothing great has really occurred in this 7 years as one major thing. It has been several things that have been increasing throughout the world every day. And in greater numbers, and just incredible weather changes, and political discord, and personal separations of people because of their thoughts and their hearts have caused families to split apart. And there's this underlying attitude between families of politics that they should believe one way or they should believe the other. And everything is kind of crumbling and breaking and fracturing apart. We can see it right before our eyes. Well, we're aware of it. Now, wanted to, as I looked at the Jonah, at that ta that happened in the early 1900s there, and I realized it was 7 years, 7 months, and 7 days, I thought, well, this actual period of time, which is not even quite 7 years, it's just under, right? Well, I thought to myself, what is the numerical sign beyond the Jonah code and everything that Yahuwah has given us? But what is the numerical? Is there a numerical understanding with regards to this one? I thought, well, a little bit separate from the Jonah code, but by way of it, I started pondering this. And I looked at the different numbers regarding the time period of that entire process, realized that the actual amount of days of this period of Ta crossing is 2,423 actual days from the first day of the crossing to the very last day of the crossing. So I thought, 2423. Well, if there's anything the Jonah code has taught me, it's that I need to be looking in scripture for significance. So I thought, well, are there other scriptures like the revelation of scriptures that we're compiling that are similar that the Jonah code would impart, or that rather this Ta days would impart? So I started looking at that. And I noticed, by way, turn in your books, if you would, to first of all, we're going to be looking at the 23rd book, and we're going to be looking at the 24th book of the Bible today. And we're going to be looking at first the 24th book of the Bible, and we're going to be reading the 23rd chapter today. Isn't that wonderful? And let's just see if by chance, I have 57 pages showing there's no chance in these numbers, brothers and sisters. But let's just see what Yahuwah would say to us by way of not words in our ears, and not by way of dreams at night, but by way of his actual word that he gives to everyone to study and learn from. So Jeremiah, the 24th book and the 23rd chapter, verse 1. Let's get started. Woe to the shepherds, destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares Yahuwah. Therefore says Yahuwah, Eloi Ya'am of Yisrael, against the shepherds who feed my people, you have scattered my flock, driven them away, have not tended them. See, I am punishing you for the evil of your deeds, declares Yahuwah. Well, let's stop right there. As we look around, dear brothers and sisters, at all these religions, that's part of the harlot. And the harlot is not just one little group of religion. The harlot is all religions, because the harlot has permeated all religions. So therefore, all these religions are of the great harlot. They are false religion. And so he says to them, you're not tending my flock properly, and you're doing badness, you're doing evil deeds. Well, what are some of the things that they're doing when they're not tending to the flock? Well, Master said that you'll know me, you'll know my people, because of the love that we have for one another, right? And so when you look around, you'll see what appears to be love, but it's not true love. It's a love for those that are in the club mainly, right? If you belong, if you're part of that circle or family, or even if you're in that group sometimes, if there's reasons for them to look at you and say, well, you're not really one of us, you don't believe in the same way that we believe, there's a sense of difference there and indifference of the heart by those people, right? Because they don't treat each other properly. And you'll see rumor spreading, you'll see people just not treating each other, especially these days, in a way that's not like maybe it used to be. Churches, especially these big, huge corporate churches, they have become so impersonal that people don't really even truly know each other. Not like it used to be. Well, he says, therefore, verse 3, I shall gather the remnant. Here we go with a gathering statement, a harpazo, rapturing or rapaport of his people. Therefore, I shall gather the remnant of my flock out of the lands where I have driven them. I shall bring them back to their fold, and they shall bear and increase. And I shall raise up shepherds over them, and they shall feed them, and they shall fear no more, nor be discouraged, nor shall they be lacking. Now here we go with that, this is one of these chapters of multiple prophecy, especially with Jeremiah and Isaiah. You'll notice there's prophecy for their day or close to their day, and then there's prophecy in the latter days. There's a two-part. And so the first part, yes, has passed, just like the first part of our master's coming has passed. But there's a second part of days that are coming. And these are the days of our master's return and all the things leading up to his return. So it says in verse 5, see, the days are coming, declares Yahuwah, when I shall raise for Dawud a branch of righteousness, and a sovereign shall reign and act wisely, and shall do right ruling and righteousness in the earth. In his days, Yehuda shall be saved, and Yisrael dwell safely. And this is his name, whereby he shall be called Yahuwah, our righteousness. You see, declaration of our master and his name, provided and given by his father, and also by way of the prophets to declare to us the return of our master and the return of him with his name intact. It says, therefore, see, the days are coming, declares Yahuwah, when they shall say no more, as Yahuwah lives, who brought up the children of Yisrael out of the land of Mitzrayim. See, there's that saving, gathering, and rapturing, and taking out, and harpazo that occurred at that time, which we're reading about in Yasher right now. So it says in verse 8, but as Yahuwah lives, as Yahuwah who brought up and led the seed of the house of Yisrael out of the land of the north and from all the lands where I had driven them, and they shall dwell on their own soil. My heart within me is broken because of the prophets. All my bones shake. I am like a drunken man and like a man overcome by wine because of Yahuwah and because of his set apart words. Now, prophets, brothers and sisters, that word is very interesting. There are many prophets, but know that the word prophet is a very subjective word. The prophets that we know of, like Jeremiah, Yirmiyahu, or Isaiah, Yashayahu, the prophets that we know, they are Yahuwah's prophets. And those are the prophets that we listen to, not the prophets of the world. By definition, they are prophets, but in their own way. And they're prophets generally for profit. So isn't that an interesting play on words? But, however, it says in verse 11, or actually verse 10, the land is filled with adulterers. The land mourns because of a curse. Oh, brothers and sisters, verse 10, and I won't tell you about the Jonah Code, but now begins the portion that the Jonah Code leads me to by way of its numbers, not the entirety of this chapter. But in verse 10, it's talking about a curse. And we know the mark of the ta being to be marked. It also can mean a curse, not just repentance. There's different meanings for ta. If you look up the word ta and you look at all the facets of the understanding of it, you begin to see the greater understanding of what's happening. For some people, the ta is a repentant mark, much to the chagrin of Jonah, who didn't really like Nineveh and who really was confounded by their repentance. He didn't like that because, see, for so long, they had been doing so much badness. They were adulterers, right, in the word and in their walk. And so he hated them. And whereas Jonah, he didn't walk that way. But to the point, the way that he didn't even want to be amongst those people. And yet, when the people of Nineveh, who were cursed for that seven-year period, they actually ended up repenting. And it's interesting because know that when this seven-year period happened, also, brothers and sisters, there is an understanding of the Jonah Code there that's right in those years. And so that blew my mind when I saw that. I didn't know that those years would work out in similar fashion. And so when I looked at this, I looked a little closer and I saw, look it, they repented at the 11th hour. Because when Jonah came, it was in that last year of that 7 years. And he said, you have 40 days, people, to get it together. And if you don't get it together, you're done. And lo and behold, well, as you know, they did. And so at the same time Jonah was there, there was also an eclipse. And so by this dual prophetic word given by Jonah to the people of Nineveh, and at the very same moment, Yahuwah creating or allowing this eclipse, this is what caused the people to finally wake up. Now, we don't have records at that period of time of that great eclipse that show that there was an eclipse 7 years prior to that great eclipse, which there is record of. It's recorded date and year by way of writings. By way of examination, you can narrow it down to June of, let's see, I think it's 780. No, wait, see, 763 is the year and the month. And 770, isn't it interesting? Because we talked about 7 years, 7 months, 7 days for the 1900s ta. Isn't it interesting that it would be the year 770 BC that 7 year period would have began, that the distress that was occurring would have begun to happen for Nineveh? And I would not be surprised, even though there's no record of it, that there was not if there was not an eclipse over Nineveh that X'd directly right there in the midst of the heart of Nineveh for a 7 year period. In fact, in my heart, I know it, though there's no proof of it. And that was in the year 770. Isn't that interesting? And not by chance, dear brothers and sisters. So these are all signs to be aware and to be awake that right now we are living in this latter period of time. And so further, as it begins to talk about this curse in verse 10, it says, "The pastures of the wilderness are dried up. Their course is evil. Their might is not right. For both prophet and priest have become defiled. Even in my house I have found their evil, declares Yahuwah." Well, certainly we know that just because there are those who might know the name even of Yah, they might even know the covenant, does not mean that there are not evil deeds being known by Yahuwah that are occurring there. And that lack of love that Master says we're to have for one another that sets you apart from the entire world, which even encompasses people that know the name in the covenant. That loving way, and Yahuwah knows about it. And it's a defilement that's occurring even in his own house, if you will. Well, his own house here on earth nowadays are the people of Yahuwah who know the name and know the covenant. And they keep perhaps the different festivals, and they do different things. And they maybe at first there was this zeal, but then they start to revert in their hearts and in their ways and in their attitudes to a more unloving way. And they even begin to separate themselves from, firstly, some statements in Scripture that are prepared and designed for loving people. And they separate themselves even from the apostles because they don't like some of the things they say. And then eventually that leads them to separate themselves from the disciples in some ways. And in other ways, if not publicly in their hearts, they've separated themselves even from our Master. Sad, isn't it? And Yahuwah has found this, and he knows it. Verse 12, it says, "Therefore, their way is to bring them like slippery ways in the dark. They are driven on, and they shall fall in them, for I bring evil on them. The year of their punishment, declares Yahuwah." Now, this is in the midst of the Jonah Code, separate from the 24, 23 days of the Mark of the Taw. This is in the midst of the Jonah Code. And so what we're seeing here, dear brothers and sisters, when it talks about the year of their punishment, I do believe that this is that year quite possibly, or at least the season is that year of 2024. We, only time will tell if this will come to pass. But that is also, again, the year of that final crossing of the Taw. And so when it refers to the year of their punishment, who knows what that means? Does that mean that they will be left when others are taken, when others are gathered, when others are safely removed and cared for and given other land and other lands? Verse 13, "And I have seen folly in the prophets of Shomron. They prophesied by Baal and led my people Yisrael astray. And among the prophets of Jerusalem, I have seen a horrible matter, committing adultery and walking in falsehood." Now again, we talked, brothers and sisters, that there are prophets of Yahuwah, and then there are prophets of people who say, "Well, I got this dream. Yahuwah spoke to me in this dream." Or, "Yahuwah spoke to me, I heard him say." See, these are the things that we're hearing from people more and more, especially these days. We're hearing people declare dreams, and we're hearing people declare that they even hear prophetic words from Yahuwah. And yet we know Yahuwah has really given us all the prophecy that we need in the Bible. All he's doing for you and me now is allowing us to see what he's already given us. And so when he removes that veil, that's not prophecy for us, brothers and sisters. We're not prophets. We're simply people who are able to see. Paul, he was made to see, was he not? And others who Master healed, and he said, "Now you can see, do bad no more, sin no more." And that's all we are trying to do. And to declare that loving way among our brothers and sisters, to read the word and let the word speak to you. And don't declare, "Oh, that Yahuwah told me this and said such and such and such and such, or my dream says this or that. Now, we don't oppose someone who says, I had this interesting dream and here's what it is. No, in fact, it is entirely possible that dream is a statement of something. And certainly, if somebody tells me that they heard Yahuwah's voice, I'm not even going to tell them I don't believe you. What I'm going to say, or what I'm going to do, is in my heart and mind, look at their works, look at their statements, look at their walk, look at their actions, and weigh carefully their words with all of that, knowing that they're not perfect people, but knowing that there are certain key markers of a person that loves and is of Yahuwah. They're a covenant keeper in the way of love. They're a name keeper in the name of Yahuwah, Father, the Son, and the set apart Spirit, Ruach. They're a person who walks in expectation of the kingdom and the good news for his barley and wheat. And so we look at all that and we weigh all that and compare them to other prophets, and then we'll know, right, who they are. I've yet to really see one. But we won't discourage it, because Scripture says we're not allowed to. In other words, we're not to put down that, right? Didn't Paul say that? That there are the gifts that people will be given, and we're not to look at those gifts and roll our eyes, but we're to test all things. We can roll our eyes later after we test it and we find out it's all bunk, right? All right, moving on in verse 14. He says further that they strengthen the hands of the evil one. These are these false prophets, these ones that are doing bad. He says, so that no one turns back from his evil. All of them are like Sodom to me, and her inhabitants are like Gomorrah. Therefore, thus says Yahuwah of hosts concerning the prophets, see, I am making them eat wormwood. Well, this has aspects of great tribulation coming on here, doesn't it? And I shall make them drink poisoned water. That's also part of that revelation that we have learned about the latter days in the great tribulation. For defilement has gone out into all the land from the prophets of Jerusalem. Thus said Yahuwah of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They lead you astray. They speak a vision of their own heart, not from the mouth of Yahuwah. See, this is why we test all things. So we don't despise prophecy if it is truly of Yahuwah. But we have to test all things. That's why Paul said it. 23:17 here. It says, they keep on saying to those who despise me, Yahuwah has said, you shall have peace. And to all who walk according to the stubbornness of their own heart, they say, no evil comes upon you. And brothers and sisters, I cannot help but in this scripture hear the words of all these ones and all these churches and different kahals, kingdom halls, and temples, and gatherings across this earth when they say, saved by grace, saved by grace. No evil comes upon you. No evil comes upon you. Saved by grace sounds like the same thing, doesn't it? But you see, they don't declare the truth of the saving way. And so further it says in 18, for who has stood in the counsel of Yahuwah and has seen and heard his word? Who has listened to his word and obeyed it? See, a storm of Yahuwah shall go forth in a rage, a whirling storm. It whirls on the head of the wrong. The displeasure of Yahuwah shall not turn back until he has done and established the purposes of his heart. In the latter days, you shall understand it perfectly. Well, there have never been latter days, brothers and sisters, until the end day. And we are in the end days. So you can see how some of these words were for the people of those days, and some of these words were for the people in the last day. In the latter days, you shall understand it a little bit. No, he says, you shall understand it perfectly. Brothers and sisters, these first 20 verses of this 23rd chapter of this 24th book could not be any clearer to you and I, could they? Well, 21 says, I did not send these prophets, yet they ran. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, then they would have let my people hear my words. They would have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their deeds. Now, at the time that Jeremiah wrote these down, when it says they would have let my people hear my words, was it speaking of the Bibles that we have, the 66 books and all the other Apocrypha books that we have now? No. In fact, these words weren't, most of them weren't even written down pen to paper. What word is being discussed? The word of Yahuwah, the covenant word of Yahuwah. The 10 covenant words that he gave his people, that we have had, that we have always had, and that yet is not being declared, and especially the third and the fourth covenant word. Like we declared today, you go to all these different churches, and some of them may do some of the first words of Yahuwah, and some of them may selectively do all of them but one. But we know that if there's anything that's going on in the religious world today, it is that there is lots of pagan adultery going on with fusion of what seems to be spiritual or set apart, but fused with satanic element, with element of going back to Nimrod. And it's very subtle. And people make excuses, you notice. Religiondom makes excuses for why they will still do certain things, keep certain holidays and do certain things and have certain idols within their churches. And yet we know that that fusion, there is no fusion of anything with Yahuwah. We strictly do his covenant word, which says remove the contaminations. Then there are others who will remove contaminations and they'll say, well, we won't celebrate holidays and we won't keep idols and crosses and other types of ornaments and things and do holidays and such, but we will not do those things. But however, they won't keep his name set apart. They'll say it's okay to use these other names that have Zeus in it or other Jehovah name in the names that they declare, when it says that we are to keep his name as set apart and not treat it as unimportant. Or there's yet other churches that will say, well, we'll do all of that, but we don't believe, you know, we know Hebrew and we keep certain laws and customs and we do a lot of things, but we don't believe that there is need for a Sabbath anymore. Can you believe that? There are literally those who declare all these different things and keep all these other laws of the 10, but that's the one thing they're not going to do, and they make excuse for it. So if you don't do one of these things, then you don't do any of them. And that's what the scriptures have taught us. And so, because of all this hypocrisy, all of these different groups and gatherings are of the harlot, and especially if they don't do it in love. And so he says, they would have let my people hear my words, and they would have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their deeds. Well, these are not popular words, are they? But we're not in a popularity contest, are we? We are in the work of doing his will, and it is about our eternal salvation that is on the line if we don't do things just so. 23:23 of Jeremiah. Am I an Eloiyam close by, declares Yahuwah, and not an Eloiyam afar off? If anyone is hidden in secret places, I would not see him, right? That's in question form. If anyone is in hidden secret places, would I not see him, declares Yahuwah. Do I not fill the Shemayim and earth, declares Yahuwah. I have heard what the prophets have said, who prophesy falsehood in my name, saying, I have dreamed. Till when shall it be in the heart of the prophets of falsehood and prophets of the deceit of their own heart, who try to make my people forget my name, who try to make my people forget my name. Isn't that interesting? And quite successfully so, right, brothers and sisters, down to this time. It says, by their dreams, which everyone relates to his neighbor, as their fathers forgot my name for Baal. Well, we see that they have forgotten Yahuwah's name for Zeus' name, Jesus. They have forgotten Yahuwah's name for Hovah's name. Strong's declares Hovah's ruin mischief as a destroyer. But they have forgotten Yahuwah for Hovah. How sad. How sad. The Jehovah and the Jesus. Verse 28. The prophet who has a dream, let him relate the dream. And he who has my word, let him speak my word in truth. Listen to this. What is the chaff to the wheat, declares Yahuwah? Is not my word like a fire, declares Yahuwah, and like a hammer that shatters a rock? Therefore, see, I am against the prophets, declares Yahuwah, who steal my words, every one from his neighbor. See, I am against the prophets, declares Yahuwah, who use their tongues and say, he declares. See, I am against those who prophesy false dreams, declares Yahuwah, and relate them and lead my people astray by their falsehoods and by their reckless boasting. But I myself did not send them, nor have I commanded them. And they do not profit this people at all, declares Yahuwah. And when these people or the prophet or the priest ask you, saying, what is the message of Yahuwah? Then you shall say to them, what message? I shall forsake you, declares Yahuwah. As for the prophet and the priest and the people who say, the message of Yahuwah, I shall punish that man and his house. This is what each one says to his neighbor and each one to his brother. What has Yahuwah answered? And what has Yahuwah spoken? Now we go to verse 23 or verse 36 of chapter 23. It says, but the message of Yahuwah you no longer remember. For every man's message is his own word, and you have changed the words of the living Elohim of Yahuwah of hosts, our Elohim. This is what you say to the prophet. What has Yahuwah answered you? And what has Yahuwah spoken? But since you say the message of Yahuwah, therefore thus said Yahuwah, because you say this word, the message of Yahuwah, and I have sent to you saying, do not say the message of Yahuwah. Therefore, see, I shall utterly forget you and cast you away from my presence, along with the city that I gave you and your fathers. And I shall put an everlasting reproach on you and an everlasting shame that is not forgotten. Yahuwah showed me, and look. Now we're getting into 24, and we're going to read chapter 24. He says, and this is because, yes, 24, 23, but 24 connected to 23 very significantly, and we'll see what happens as we read this. Yahuwah showed me, and look, there were two baskets of figs set before the temple of Yahuwah after Nebuchadnezzar, sovereign of Babel, had exiled Yekonah, son of Yahuyakim, sovereign of Yehuda, and the heads of Yehuda with the craftsmen and smiths from Jerusalem, and had brought them to Babel. One basket had very good figs, like the figs that are first ripe. Isn't that interesting? The first ripe fruits. So that would be one basket that we're talking about. Now, figs certainly are not barley. Figs are not wheat. Figs are not grapes, as we have learned, or these three groups in the latter days here. But figs sort of represent all of his people, if you will. So it says, one basket had very good figs, like the figs that are first ripe, and the other basket had very spoiled figs, which could not be eaten. They were so spoiled. And Yahuwah said to me, what do you see, Yirmiyahu? And I said, figs, the good figs, very good, and the spoiled, very spoiled, which could not be eaten. They are so spoiled. Again, the word of Yahuwah came to me, saying, thus said Yahuwah, the Elohim of Yisrael, like these good figs, so do I acknowledge the exiles of Yehuda, whom I have sent out of this place for their own good into the land of the Chaldean. Now, brothers and sisters, a lot of people say, oh, all this badness, why do we even have to be a part of this world? Why do we even have to be here to grow up in this world and go through the things that we've gone through? Because, brothers and sisters, this is a testing zone. This whole life, this whole 6,000 years has been 6,000 years of testing. The heavens had their testing, and we're having our testing as people. And he's going to take the good figs. And especially will he remove the first ripe good figs. And so how blessed we are to be part of that group. But we need to Also warn others that they don't be part of the bad figs. Get out from among the harlot. Separate yourself from all the badness, because it literally will mean your eternal life if you mingle with the badness of this world, which only becomes magnified in every single group as the days have gone by. I can tell you that in the religion I was raised in, I knew of no better and greater group to be with than a lot of those people who I felt were so set apart and seemed so righteous. It was only over the years that Yahuwah said that there's nothing hidden that he shall not reveal. And so he has allowed all these groups, and it's not just one or two, it's all of them. There's badness being revealed. Get out from among those groups and draw yourself to Yahuwah, because you are a temple that's to remain undefiled. And because you are now the temple of Yahuwah, do not allow it to backstep into the old way and become like those bad prophets who are in his house that he calls out. But be good fruit in a good temple, doing good things, and be the first good ripe figs, brothers and sisters. He says, like these good figs, so do I acknowledge the exiles of Yehuda whom I've sent out of this place for their own good. Well, this is for our own good, just like we've stated. Further in verse 6 now, it says, and I shall set my eyes on them for good, shall bring them back to this land. I shall build them and put and not pull them down, shall plant them and not pluck them up. And I shall give them a heart to know me, that I am Yahuwah. And they shall be my people, and I shall be their Elohi Ya'am, for they shall turn back to me with all their heart. And as the spoilt figs that could not be eaten because they are so spoiled, for thus says Yahuwah, so do I give up Siddiqui-Yahu, the sovereign of Yehuda, his heads, the rest of Yerushalem, who remain in this land, and those who dwell in the land of Mitzrayim. And I shall make them a horror to all the reigns of the earth for evil, to be a reproach and a byword, a mockery and a curse in all the places to which I drive them. And I shall send the sword, the scarcity of food, the pestilence among them, and they are consumed from the land that I gave to them and their fathers. Here we go, brothers and sisters, with that statement of a curse again. You see, we don't want to be part of that curse. Though it may be all around us, we want to be in repentance like Nineveh, where the world will suffer by way of their unrepentant ways until the day that maybe they will wake up. Maybe they will finally see. Maybe they will become the wheat later. We want them to be the good figs now. So it says in verse 10, scarcity of food. Well, pestilence as well. Aren't we hearing and seeing things happening right now, which if you have your eyes open, you can see how as these latter days go by, things are being set in place. I can see great worldwide food shortage. I can see scarcity of food. We can see pestilence, disease, and all these different things growing for different reasons. People want to modify bodies. People want to modify food with different injection. And these things are going, and they also want to modify the skies with injections into the air. These are the things that are going to cause scarcities of food and pestilence and disease and all sorts of issues and problems. The world is literally bringing these plagues upon themselves. Yahuwah just needs to remove the restrainer and let it happen. We are our own worst enemies in this world. Well, that concludes 23 and 24. Now, turn, if you would, to the 23rd book, Isaiah, and chapter 24. And let's read that together. And we reverse that order of 24, 23, and it becomes 23:24. Before we do that, we're going to do the same thing that we did in Isaiah, or rather Jeremiah, where we read chapters 23 and 24. We're going to read 23 and 24 also. It says in 23, chapter 23, verse 1, and before we get to 24, the message concerning Sor, howl, you ships of Tarshish, for it has been destroyed without a house, without harbor, from the land of Kittim has been revealed to them. By the way, brothers and sisters, you're going to notice parallels in Isaiah here, 23 and 24, and Yirmiyahu 23 and 24. Interestingly enough, as the 24-23 days of this Mark of the Taw. Further, it says, and by way of verse 1, I want you to take notice there, notes of Revelation in that as well, and the ships. Verse 2, be silent, you inhabitants of the coastland, you merchants of Sidon, who passed over the sea, they filled you. The great waters of the grain of Shihor, the harvest of the rivers, was her increase, and she was a marketplace for the nations. Well, we know as things get worse, brothers and sisters, in the latter days, we know that the marketplace is what suffers especially when the world ends up being tribulated and in turmoil. And when the marketplace suffers, all the items and all the ships and all the different trucks and trains and all the things that move these goods, they are directly affected because of a market issue. And so this prophecy is in tune with especially what Revelation tells us. Verse 4, it says, be ashamed, O Sidon, for the sea has spoken, the stronghold of the sea, saying, I have not labored nor brought forth children, neither have I reared young men, brought up maidens. See, that is the harlot. The harlot actually makes this statement in Revelation, does she not? And so part of that prophetic word. Verse 5, like the report of Mitzrayim, they too are grieved at the report of Sor. Pass over to Tarshish. Wail, you inhabitants of the coastland. Is this your city of revelry, whose antiquity is from days of old, whose feet carried her far off to sojourn? Interesting, the her, because it is, after all, the harlot. Who has counseled this against Sor, the crowning city? Whose merchants are chiefs? Whose traders are the esteemed of the earth? Yahuwah of hosts has counseled it to defile the pride of all splendor and to shame all the esteemed of the earth. That's especially what it was saying in Yirmiyahu. Jeremiah was talking about those who were esteemed, how they would no longer be esteemed. Verse 10, overflow through your land like the river, O daughter of Tarshish. There is no more strength. He has stretched out his hand over the sea. He shook the reins. Yahuwah has given a command against Canaan to destroy its strongholds. And he said, never again shall you exalt. O you oppressed maiden, daughter of Sidon, arise, pass over to Kittim. Even there you shall find no rest. See, the land of the Chaldeans, this people did not exist. Asher found it for wild beasts in the desert. They set up their siege towers. They demolished her palaces and made her a ruin. Interesting, too, that the word beast, if I'm not mistaken, that number was 2423 in Strong's. Howl, you ships of Tarshish, for your stronghold is laid waste. And in that day it shall be that Sor is forgotten 70 years, according to the days of one sovereign. And at the end of 70 years, it shall be to Sor as in the song of the whore. Now, before we go further, interesting here, talks about the whore, the harlot, talks about the 70-year period, which many of us believe there's been a 70 years of relative peace in Israel and Jerusalem, physically here on earth. Though there has been some tumultuous times here and there, but overall, certainly the distress is nothing like what is coming. Further, it says, take a lair, go about the city, you forgotten whore, make sweet playing, sing many songs, so that you might be remembered. And at the end of 70 years, it shall be that Yahuwah visits Sor, and she shall return to her hire and commit whoring with all the rains of the earth on the face of the soil. And her goods and her hire shall be set apart for Yahuwah, not treasured nor laid up. For her gain is for those who dwell before Yahuwah, to eat sufficiently, and for a choice covering. See, Yahuwah is making the earth empty, making it waste, and shall overturn its surface, and shall scatter abroad its inhabitants. And it shall be as with the people, so with the priest. As with the servant, so with his master. As with the female servant, so with her mistress. As with the buyer, so with the seller. As with the lender, so with the borrower. And as with the creditor, so with the debtor. Further it says, the earth is completely emptied, utterly plundered. For Yahuwah has spoken this word. The earth shall mourn and wither. The world shall languish and wither. The haughty people of the earth shall languish. For the earth has been defiled under its inhabitants because they have transgressed the Torah, changed the law, broken the everlasting covenant. Yep, it is pride, brothers and sisters, that Shaitan uses as one of his greatest weapons to destroy the people of the earth, to cause them to turn away from the covenant word or Torah of the everlasting covenant. If anybody says, well, the Torah isn't forever, the covenant isn't forever. Verse 5 says, everlasting covenant. This is one of many places in scriptures that do show that we are to keep his covenant word forever. Verse 6, and very poignantly, and part of the Jonah code, therefore, a curse shall consume the earth. Those who dwell in it be punished. Therefore, the inhabitants of the earth shall be burned, and few men shall be left. The new wine shall fail. The vine shall languish. All those glad at heart shall sigh. See, there's hope for those glad at heart, even though we're going to be looking around and we're going to see these people and go, oh boy. Verse 8, the joy of the tambourine shall cease. The noise of those who rejoice shall end. The joy of the lyre shall cease. Well, that's what it says in Revelation with regards to the different musical instruments no longer being heard. And remember how it says the light of the lamp shall no longer be seen, which I do believe in part, at least, is talking about the media and Hollywood and all things that go through that light of the lamp that sits on your wall in different colors of pearl and ruby. And anyway, the spectrum of television is also those same gems that are declared in Revelation. So that's something that I just felt the understanding in by way of Yahuwah's word. Now it says in verse 9, no more do they drink wine with a song. Strong drink is bitter to those who drink it. The deserted city shall be broken down. Every house shall be shut. No one enters. And by the way, we're in chapter 24 now, for those of you that didn't know. The deserted, there is a crying for wine in the streets. All joy shall be darkened. The gladness of the earth shall be gone. The city is left in ruins, and the gate is stricken with destruction. For thus it is to be in the midst of the earth among the peoples, like the shaking of an olive tree, like the gleaning of grapes when the grape harvest is done. Isn't that interesting? It says like the shaking of an olive tree and like the gleaning of grapes when the grape harvest is done. So it's talking about when this harvest occurs, when people would literally harvest and it was all done, what was once there is all torn up, right? Everything is torn up. The barley, when it's done, all those stalks are torn and trampled out, cut out, tossed away once the barley's removed. Same thing with the wheat. Once that wheat is removed, those beautiful wheat fields completely gone. And all you're going to see is the chaff. All you're going to see is the stalks. And just like those beautiful grapes that grow. I know across my garage, the favorite part of my year, I have these grapes that grow on both sides of a double garage that goes over and meets together atop the garage. And it's so beautiful when those clusters of grapes just hang heavy and they just hang there. And it's so beautiful. And when they're gone, I'm always like, after I pick them, I'm like, well, it's, you know, it doesn't look quite so good now. But I understand verse 13 in that regard. See, when Yahuwah takes his people, when he gathers you, and the world is eventually going to know it, whether they're going to know it at that moment or whether they're going to realize it over time, they're going to know it. And it's going to be something that is absolutely going to be barren of all his people, of all that fine, ripe, and fresh fig. Verse 14, they lift up their voice. They sing of the excellency of Yahuwah. They shall cry aloud from the sea. Therefore, praise Yahuwah in the east. The name of Yahuwah, Eloi Ya'am of Yasserel, in the coastlands of the sea. Well, here in California, we are a coastland, and so I love the fact that Praise Yahuwah is based here and that we declare the importance of the name. Somehow I feel like it's a prophecy that has come true in my own life and with all of you and with all of us. And isn't it wonderful? And that's why we say be a part of PraiseYahuwah.com and give to others the website. Write it down and go, here, check this out. Let people know the name and let them hear these truths. Don't hide the coin. Let the coin be heard and let the coin be given. Verse 16, from the ends of the earth, we shall hear songs, splendor to the righteous one. But I say, I waste away. I waste away. Woe to me, the treacherous betray, with the treachery of the treacherous betray. Fear and the pit and the snare are upon you, O inhabited of the earth. And it shall be that he who flees from the noise of the fear falls into the pit, and he who comes up from the midst of the pit is caught in the snare. For the windows from on high shall be opened, and the foundations of the earth shall be shaken. Well, certainly verse 18, it shows when it talks about the firmament and that area being open. And we know that Revelation talks about that also being opened, like rolling apart like a scroll, literally. So we see the connections. The foundations of the earth being shaken is something that all the prophets, it seems, have been talking about through the centuries. Verse 19 of chapter 24, the earth shall be utterly broken. The earth shall be completely shattered. The earth shall be fiercely shaken. But I don't know about you, brothers and sisters, but I want out of here. And I want you out of here with me, because there are some scary times coming. Verse 20, and it's funny, you talk to people about all of this, and most of the people, they're just going to laugh at you. Their pride and their I know better attitude and their lack of respect for all things, truly. They're just going to laugh at you, and they're going to laugh at Yahuwah. But don't worry, because you will be with Yahuwah, and your joy will be sevenfold. Verse 20, the earth shall stagger like a drunkard, and it shall totter like a hut. Its transgression shall be heavy upon it, and it shall fall and not rise again. And in that day it shall be that Yahuwah punishes on high the host of exalted ones, and on the earth the sovereigns of the earth. By the way, that's part of the Jonah code. And they shall be gathered together as prisoners are gathered on the pit, and shall be shut up in the prison, and be punished after many days. And the moon shall blush, and the sun shall be ashamed. For Yahuwah of hosts shall reign on Mount Zion, and in Jerusalem, and before his elders in esteem. Which elders is that? Oh, well, we're in the 24th chapter. Could it be the 24 elders? 24 brothers and sisters. The scripture ends in 24:23. Isn't that interesting? And the days of the mark of the Ta are 24:23 days. And in this ending of the mark of the Ta, the moon blushes, brothers and sisters, because the moon turns reddish when there's an eclipse in front of the sun. And the sun is hidden, because what happens when we're ashamed? We bow our heads, and sometimes we'll even put our hand in front of our face. The sun shall be ashamed. Brothers and sisters, 24:23 is another code within the Jonah code of the days of the mark of the Ta. And if 24:23, the exact number of days of these years of the Jonah code of the mark of the Ta, is not enough of a witness, if the fact that the absolute epicenter is Salem, if the fact that there are three Salems as well at the very last Ta that the eclipse goes over, which creates a Dalet, which also has a code, which also declares the truth of these things. And if the fact that the 24 elders in Revelation before was not known to you as being the 144,000, you need to know it now. So when it says in Jeremiah that in that year, it says in that year that they're going to, these bad ones are going to realize the badness and the error of their way. If you didn't realize it before, that 2024 could quite possibly be the season, not of our master's return. We're not declaring any date, nor shall we ever declare the day of his return. We are declaring to be awake, as the scriptures say we must be. We are declaring that you and I are to be searching out and seeking in and standing firm in and being on the watch from his word. Because brothers and sisters, there is all the prophecy in the world that you shall understand in the latter days that you are understanding right now. Praise Yahuwah. Well, I hope that this has blessed you as much as it has absolutely and incredibly blessed my family. My wife and I, our faith, our belief, and our expectation is like nothing that we have ever felt before. And it is like nothing that we have ever seen or heard before in our entire life. If you are seeing this, and if you are understanding this, oh, how blessed you are. Because I want you to know something. Most of the world, 99.9999%, A, would not let themselves even see this. B, even if they saw or heard this, would not even recognize it or understand it. If you do, then Yahuwah has blessed you this day. Well, let's get started, brothers and sisters, and at least get a chapter in, if not two. We'll see what we can do. And the book of Yasher. Book of Yasher, wonderful book. And we are in the midst of Mitzrayim and the bondage that was occurring. And Moshe, who was born and raised up, and from an infant knew he was a Hebrew, according to these words. And even those in the court and around him in the actual kingly court of the perhaps pyramid or area around the pyramids there of Pharaoh actually knew that he was Hebrew. And we learned that last week, which is incredible, because we've always understood that nobody knew that he was someone like that. But you see, even though they knew, how wonderful it was that there would be those that would rise up against him and want to destroy him. And yet Yahuwah, what did he do? He set it up to where that false prophet who counseled the Pharaoh last week to destroy Moses, Yahuwah sent an angel disguised as a human being, which he does. We'll never know when we come upon an angel of Yahuwah, a messenger of Yahuwah. You know, I dare say that you and I will at least one time in our lifetime meet with a messenger of Yahuwah and not even know it. And so this messenger of Yahuwah was sent in among the people that were counseling the Pharaoh. And this messenger told the Pharaoh, hey, I got an idea. Have a onyx stone and have a burning hot coal and put it in front of Moses. Don't kill Moses. Let him choose which stone he wants. And if he chooses the black onyx stone, kill him. But if he chooses the burning hot coal, let him live. Well, obviously, they would have thought that's a slam dunk. We know he'll choose the stone. He's not going to want to go near something or touch something hot. But what did Moses do? He picked up the stone and he put it in his mouth. And it actually disfigured his mouth. Did you know that? His tongue and his lips, it says. And so now we know why Moses more than likely had a speaking impediment. And so this was caused from this situation. But guess what? It saved his life for greater things. So when you go through things in your life that seem tough, and know that these things sort of mold you. These are the scars that you've earned to physically and emotionally to bring you closer to Yahuwah. no matter what it is. So take heart in that, because that allows you to forgive others for bad things they've done to you and stupid things you've done to yourself. Moving on now, chapter 71 and verse 1. It says, when Moshe was 18 years old, he desired to see his father and mother, and he went to them to Goshen. And when Moshe had come near Goshen, he came to the place where the children of Yisrael were engaged to work, and he observed their burdens. He saw a Midianite smiting one of his Hebrew brethren. When the man who was beaten saw Moshe, he ran to him for help. For the man Moshe was greatly respected in the house of Pharaoh, and he said to him, my head, attend to me. This Midianite came to my house in the night, bound me, came to my wife in my presence, and now he seeks to take my life away. And when Moshe heard this wicked thing, his anger was kindled against the Midianite. First of all, I want to stop there. Did we not always hear that it was simply this Egyptian who was beating this person, and that's why Moshe got angry? No, it was more to it than this. These people were being horrifically raped and abused in every single way. And isn't it interesting how the court of Pharaoh really had no idea of these things? They were insulated from it. They didn't see what was happening. And Moshe, he had no idea these things were going on. So one day, when he was 18 and he's finally grown up, and when you start to get older, you start to think about things more, right? Who are my parents, and what are they all about, and what are they like, what about my life and my past don't I know that I might learn from them? So he was starting to get all these things building up in their minds and question certain things, and so he then goes and sees this, and of course it really ticks him off. So it says that he turned this way and the other, and when he saw there was no man there, he smote the Midianite and hid him in the sand and delivered the Hebrew from the hand of him that smote him. Well, sometimes I think that people that commit sexual crimes should be dealt with in the same way, but I digress. It seems here that it's a little more plausible why Moshe would have done what he did. But it says the Hebrew went to his house, and Moshe returned to his home and went forth and came back to the king's house. When the man had returned home, he thought of repudiating his wife, for it was not right in the house of Jacob for any man to come to his wife after she had been defiled. Well, the woman went and told her brothers, and the woman's brothers sought to slay him, and he fled to the house and escaped. So kind of a sad thing, I think, that when a woman was raped back in those days, and there were a lot of different ways that they dealt with things, kind of sad that they would actually do different things to that poor woman and even a child. But at least by way of scripture, that's their understanding. But even in some countries, if a woman's raped to this very day, do you know they put her to death? Isn't that something? A woman gets raped and they put her to death. That's incredible. But that's the backwards ways of religiondom. Well, it says here that they wanted to slay this brother. Verse 7. On the second day, Moshe went forth to his brethren and saw, and behold, two men were quarreling. And he said to the wicked one, why dost thou smite thy neighbor? And he answered him and said to him, who has set thee for a prince and a judge over us? Dost thou think to slay me as thou didst slay the Midianite? Well, Moshe was afraid, because he said, surely the thing is known. Translated, brothers and sisters, the cat's out of the bag. Verse 9. Pharaoh heard of this affair. He ordered Moshe to be slain. So Yahuwah sent his messenger. He appeared unto Pharaoh in the likeness of a captain of the guard. The messenger of Almighty took the sword from the hand of the captain of the guard, took his head off with it, for the likeness of the captain of the guard was turned into the likeness of Moshe. The messenger of Almighty took hold of the right hand of Moshe and brought him forth from Mitzri and placed him from without the borders of Mitzri, a distance of 40 days' journey. Now here we go with the significance of numbers. We read in the other books 70, and we see the significance of 70 in years. We see the significance of 70 in signs in the skies, and we see the significance of other numbers with regards to revelation in Scripture and the way that Yahuwah does things. And as we are in the latter days now, Yahuwah is giving us the ability, I believe, by way of removing scales and letting us see things that we couldn't see before. And so when we look at these things like 40 days here, we want to take note of that and think about how this applies then, how it applies now. So it says Aaron, oh, and by the way, 40 days journey, Nineveh had 40 days to, if you will, walk or journey in the ways of Yahuwah in repentance. And so we see this journey, it's almost like a spiritual journey. It's something Moshe did, and it's something that he did, and I am sure he thought about things in that journey, about his life, about things he understood, about things he didn't know, and questioned things. And it opened his eyes and heart and mind. Well, verse 12, Aaron, his brother, alone remained in the land of Mitzri, and he prophesied to the children of Yisrael, saying, thus says Almighty Yahuwah of your ancestors, throw away each man the abominations of his eyes. Do not defile yourselves with the idols of Mitzri. And the children of Yisrael rebelled and would not hearken to Aaron at that time. And Almighty thought to destroy them, were it not that Almighty remembered the covenant which he had made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In those days, the hand of Pharaoh continued to be severe against the children of Yisrael, and he crushed and oppressed them until the time when Yahuwah sent forth his word and took notice of them. Well, we see a couple of things here. Aaron comes into light, and Aaron, being the brother of Moshe, he is there among the people, and he's saying, look, people, stop with the idol worship already. Stop defiling yourselves and being adulterous in the worldly ways. You see, even to this very day, even the time of Nineveh, after that, and to this day, Yahuwah still wants people to turn to his covenant and to turn away from the things, the idolatrous ways and the adulterous ways of the harlot and of false religion. He wants you to come to him and to get out of her. And he has held back from doing many things. He held back from destroying Nineveh when they had their 40 days of repentance that Jonah told them. And he held back from destroying these people here in Mitzrayim at this time. Because Aaron basically said, look, you're being given an opportunity to turn away from this badness and to turn to the covenant. And it's also interesting, too, that even though we live today in a time where there is much of this going on, even right now, Yahuwah provides an opportunity to allow people to finally wake up, let the scales be removed from their eyes, and realize slowly you need to make changes. But you need to make changes at a more rapid pace now, you know, where we had 10 years, where we had 15 years, where we thought there was time before, we're realizing there's very little time. I cannot help but think, brothers and sisters, that 5 years is because in Scripture, five is a very important number. He had them walk by fives through the Jordan River. Those in Mitzrayim, we're going to read about how they went out by fives as they cross through the sea. And by fives is a very significant meaning. We've discussed this. But I also feel that it's interesting that we've learned what we've learned right now this last couple months. We've learned what we've learned because it's a call. It's a Jonah call. It's a 40-day Jonah call by way of 5 years. Not to say that it couldn't happen at any moment, but certainly we do believe that there are signs here that Yahuwah is giving the world, and when he gives them 7 years of repentance or 7 years of sign, it's so that they can repent, just like Nineveh. Otherwise, why would he kill them before the hour of opportunity ends, which is, I believe, in 4-8-2024. So he always gives warning, and we're trying to give warning. There's always been warning by the churches, repent, 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 but it's been met with shrugs and indifference, because the churches have become, especially so these days, so unrepentant and so twisted and so disgusting to the world that they don't listen to any of these false prophets, any of these false priests, as we've read about. Well, let's get another chapter in here, because this is getting really good. Chapter 72, and it was in those days that there was a great war between the children of Cush and the children of the East and Amram, and they rebelled against the king of Cush, in whose hands they were. So Cacanus, king of Cush, went with all the children of Cush, people numerous as the sand, and he went to fight against Amram and the children of the East, to bring them under subjection. And when Cacanus went out, he left Balaam the magician with his two sons to guard the city and the lowest sort of the people of the land. So Cacanus went forth to Aram and the children of the East, and he fought against them. He smote them, and they all fell down wounded before Cacanus and his people. And he took many of them captives, and he brought them under subjection as at first, and he encamped upon their land to take tribute from them as usual. And Balaam the son of Beor, when the king of Cush had left him to guard the city and the poor of the city, he rose up and advised with the people of the land to rebel against King Cacanus, not to let him enter the city when he should come home. And the people of the land hearkened to him, and they swore to him and made him king over them and his two sons for captains of the army. So they rose up, they raised the walls of the city at the two corners, and they built an exceeding strong building. And at the third corner they dug ditches without number between the city and the river, which surrounded the whole land of Cush. And they made the waters of the river burst forth there. And at the fourth corner they collected numerous serpents by their incantations and their enchantments. And they fortified the city and dwelt therein, and no one went out or in before them. And Cacanus fought against Amram and the children of the East. He subdued them as before, and they gave him their usual tribute. And he went, and he returned to his land. And when Cacanus, king of Cush, approached his city, and all the captains of the forces with him, they lifted up their eyes and saw that the walls of the city were built up, greatly elevated, so that the men were astonished at this. And they said one to the other, "It is because they saw that we were delayed in battle, and were greatly afraid of us. Therefore they have done this thing, and raised the city walls, and fortified them, so that the kings of Canaan might not come in battle against them." So the king and the troops approached the city door, and they looked up, and behold, all the gates of the city were closed. And they called out to the sentinels, saying, "Open unto us, that we may enter the city." But the sentinels refused to open to them, by the order of Balaam the magician, their king. They suffered them not to enter the city. So they raised a battle with them opposite the city gate, and 130 men of the army at Cacanus fell on that day. And on the next day they continued to fight, and they fought at the side of the river. They endeavored to pass, but were not able. So some of them sank into the pits and died. So the king ordered them to cut down trees to make rafts upon which they might pass to them, and they did so. And when they came to the place of the ditches, the waters revolved by mills, and 200 men upon 10 rafts were drowned. And on the third day they came to fight at the site where serpents were, but they could not approach there, for the serpents, they slew them. 170 men they ceased fighting against Cush, and they besieged Cush for 9 years. No person came out or in. At that time the war, which the siege were against Cush, Moshe fled from Mitzri, from Pharaoh, who sought to kill him for having slain the Mitzrayim. Moshe was 18 years old when he fled from Mitzri, from the presence of Pharaoh. He fled and escaped the camp of Cacanus, which at that time was besieging Cush. Moshe was 9 years in the camp of Cacanus, king of Cush. All the time that they were besieging Cush, Moshe went out and came in with them. Wasn't that interesting? I never knew about this 9-year period of Moshe. It's interesting, because he would have learned so much in that time, wouldn't he? He would have gone from being kind of a boy who was, not very understanding of the ways of the world, and who really didn't see things in an adult way. And over that 9-year period, until the age of 27, he would have definitely learned a lot and become a man, especially in an encampment, in an army with warriors. Well, it says in verse 24, "And the king and his princes and all the fighting men loved Moshe, for he was great and he was worthy. His stature was like a noble lion. His face was like the sun. His strength was like that of a lion. And he was a counselor to the king. And at the end of the 9 years, Kikanus was seized with a mortal disease. His illness prevailed over him, and he died on the seventh day. So his servants embalmed him, carried him, and buried him opposite the city gate to the north of the land of Mitzri. They built over him an elegant, strong, and high building. They placed great stones below. The king's scribes engraved upon those stones all the might of their king, Kikanus, and all his battles which he had fought. Behold, they are all written there at this day. Now after the death of Kikanus, king of Cush, it grieved his men and troops greatly on account of the war. So they said one to the other, 'Give us counsel, what we are to do at this time, as we have resided in the wilderness 9 years away from our homes. If we say we will fight against the city, many of us will fall wounded or killed. And if we remained here in the siege, we shall also die. For now all the kings of Aram and all the children of the east will hear that our king is dead. And they will attack us suddenly in hostile manner, and they will fight against us and leave no remnant of us. Now therefore let us go and make a king over us. Let us remain in the siege until the city is delivered up to us.' And they wished to choose on that day a man for king from the army of Kikanus. And they found no object of their choice like Moshe to reign over them. And they hastened and stripped off each man his garments, cast them upon the ground. They made a great heap and placed Moshe thereon. And they rose up and blew with trumpets and called out before him and said, 'May the king live, may the king live.' And all the people and nobles swore unto him to give him for a wife Adonia, the queen, the Cushite, wife of Kikanus. And they made Moshe king over them on that day. And all the people of Cush issued a proclamation on that day, saying, 'Ha harai! Man must give something to Moshe of what is in his possession.' And they spread out a sheet upon the heap, and every man cast into it something of what he had, a gold earring, and the other a coin, also of onyx stones and bdellium and pearls and marble, and did the children of Cush cast unto Moshe upon the heap, and also silver and gold in great abundance. And Moshe took all the silver and gold, all the vessels, all the bdellium and onyx stones, which all the children of Cush had given to him, and he placed them amongst his treasures. And Moshe reigned over the children of Cush on that day in the place of Kikanus, king of Cush." Well, this is a different story, isn't it, brothers and sisters? Maybe a more complete story about Moshe, and very, very interesting. And I'm just so happy to be reading this, and interested and thankful that this is truly my first time to read through and study Yasher, and to do it with you is a wonderful blessing, and so grateful to do that. And I hope today blesses you. I hope that that Yahuwah has brought you to an even greater level of faith and belief and discernment and understanding in the numbers that are important to him, which should be important to us. It's an important thing, because it may seem like a little thing, and it may cause some people without faith to laugh at it and say, "Oh, it's not a big deal," but it may and will cause others to look at it and be within themselves, lifted up, encouraged. What greater encouragement can you and I have in these very latter days, especially being on the watch, to know that there's things that we're going to look out for and be aware of and prepare, spiritually prepare. Prepare your body, your temple, your walk, and prepare in the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah.
This concludes our internet podcast of It's Time for Truth. I'm your servant host, Denia Cajaliero, And you need to know that your comments, suggestions, and prayers of support are very, very important to us here. Please send your contact email directly to praiseyahuwah@yahoo.com. Or go to our website and scroll down to the mailbox at www.praiseyahuwah.com. This is the day that Yahuwah has made, so rejoice and be glad in it. Until next week, be a blessing to all and be blessed.